Sarah, thank you so much. I've got a lot to live up to, and I might end up stealing that tagline if we make the magic happen. I feel like we're a little bit like Disney now, though, because and Disney sets the bar really high, so we'll see if I can live up to that. What's up, you guys? I have loved so much seeing your chat messages come in. I'm going to go to camera three over here. You guys can see this, so we're going to put this on gallery view over here, but this is my giant Zoom wall. And on my Zoom wall, I can see all of your faces. So hello over there. You guys can wave at yourself if you want to. And I can see your chat messages. So I see that Anna, North Carolina FFA camp is, I think, what that means. We've got Sarah, Maryland FFA camp. You love that one. I love that Sarah, who's kicking it off. She loves FFA camp as well. My wife was not FFA, but she was 4-H back in the day. So she showed pigs. So I definitely know the audience of what you guys are going for. Cassidy loved Kentucky State Fair an awful lot, and super excited to see what's in store back in Kentucky. So I can see you guys, and I know that you guys can see me. I've got chat here. And what's fun is I'm excited to talk to you guys about this topic about engaging your audience. And a little bit more about myself, I actually have a degree in elementary education. So I went to school for elementary education. Through random workness, I don't know if anybody else ended up going down some different path, but I now do corporate events for a living. And I've been doing it for over 10 years now. I was a contractor at our company Elevate for 5 years. And then now for 5 years since 2016, I've been on staff full time. And specifically with engaging your audience, why I'm really excited about it is it takes me all the way back to when my sister was in theater. Was anybody in theater in school or anybody involved in theater now? Put in chat or you can raise your hand. I can see you over here. Anybody involved in theater or not really? Yes or no? Thumbs up, thumbs down. Not really. Yes. Okay. Not really. Got it. Well, has anybody heard of this theater term called we got one. Laura says, whoop, whoop. Okay. Thank you, Laura. Awesome. I see that over there. So, has anybody heard of this term called the fourth wall or breaking the fourth wall? Yes or no? Head nods. Yes. A couple yeses, couple noes. Okay. Well, in theater, let's put this image full screen. And by the way, I've got a couple people in the studio that are helping me with my talk here. But so if you hear me address a different name, that's who I'm talking to. But this picture of a theater, imagine you go to watch a play. Well, the fourth wall is the first, number one, is there's three walls on this stage. There's the two side walls, and then there's the back wall. And the fourth wall is this imaginary wall between the stage and the audience. And so what's interesting is back in like Shakespeare's day, in order to stay in character, they had to literally imagine there was a wall there. And it was kind of like the chief cardinal sin to break that fourth wall. They never wanted to break character. Well, now with Beyonce concerts, with Beyonce like getting on a rope and swinging out over the crowd and people, musicians high-fiving people, I got to go to a Justin Timberlake concert and he had a stage that like wove through the audience. There's this concept now of breaking the fourth wall, right? So imagine this gigantic crack that goes up in that wall. Well, what I want to talk to you guys about specifically for audience engagement is not just a crack in the wall, but we actually want to shatter the fourth wall. So imagine if you were to, in a visceral kind of reaction, is kind of imagine you were to take a mirror, hold it in your hand, and then just drop it, right? What would happen? It would just go in pieces. And that's what engaging your audience, engaging your students is going to be a lot like, whether that's the parents, like Sarah said, whether that's your students in class, but you want to break that wall between what's happening when you're presenting or you're speaking or you're talking or you're teaching and your actual audience. And so I'm going to give you some practical tips and tricks, and I'm going to show you what it's like real time during my time with you for how to engage your audience. So here's what I want to do first. I want to get to know you a little bit more. I love getting to see a little bit of where you're from and a little bit more of what you enjoy about FFA. But now I want to get to know you a little bit personal. So these questions really have nothing to do with FFA or what we're talking about, but I'll teach you from what I'm about to do in just a second. So on screen, you should see this question. In the morning, are you a coffee person or a tea person? Put that in chat. So type in chat either coffee or tea. Rachel says coffee. Jennifer says water. Okay, well, I see you. Well, Jennifer's already going off the rails, okay? We're, you guys are already like not even listening to me. I didn't say water was an option. We've got Katie Rittenhouse says Mountain Dew all day. Thank you, Katie, for that. Caselian. Did I mispronounce that? Can you teach me how to say your name? Casey Lynn. I'm so sorry. So Casey Lynn, I love that Casey Lynn said coffee in winter and then spark in summer, which isn't even an option either. Okay, I got it. All right. So how about this one? On screen, you've got another one. If you're on your way to work, if you're driving in, are you listening to music or podcast? I will allow a third option of silence if you want to. Some people are just like, I just need silence. We've got a lot of music. Elizabeth Knight says music, Caitlin music, Jesselyn music. Jennifer says podcast with exclamation point. Sarah, podcast in all caps. Cassidy says podcast on the way to work and then sometimes silence. Okay, I got it. And the last one I have for you guys is this question. What type of event, now that we're talking about, this can be a class. Some of you might prefer online. Some of you might prefer in person. So if we're talking about an event where you're gathering people together, whether that's your students or the parents or a conference, in person or online, what do you prefer? Let's see. In person, thank you, Bailey, for in person, in all caps, I miss people's faces. Got it. You want to give them a hug? I don't know if we got anybody online. Okay, so do you at all, I don't think anybody said they prefer online, but do you at least enjoy online a little bit? A little bit? Yes. Okay, a little bit for some. Okay, yes, but we prefer online. Virtual is very convenient though. Thank you, Laura, for that. I agree with that. So there's definitely some pros and cons. Now, again, your event, when I talk about an event as I define it, because I'm an event professional, I'm an MC, a host, a moderator, and I've been doing this, a planner, I've been doing it for over 10 years. When I define an event, an event is a moment in time when something is happening, right? So that is your everyday class. That is your PTA conferences. That's your FFA conferences. That's your the showings that you're going to be happening. That's going to be the competitions. So there's a lot of different things. But regardless of what you are talking about in the context, I've got this one big picture bullet point quote for you that I'm going to share right from the beginning, is that people attend events, but they remember experiences. People attend events and they remember experiences. Now, I'm going to tell you where this is coming from, okay? The number one thing to, the most important thing you know about me is this is my family. This is my little girl, Gemma, and my wife, Natalie. We've been married for almost 7 years now, and Gemma turns 4 on July 12th. And so as a dad and as a husband, this morning I had breakfast with my family. That was an event. But this was an experience, taking a picture, going to the water at Christmas time and having a selfie with my family, right? And so sometimes we'll remember a specific moment, and why is that? Well, there's some much more important and much smarter people than I am that can tell you why, but I'm going to teach you how to create experiences with these events, okay? And so where this is coming from is at Elevate. This is our tagline for our company, is to create events that people love. Create events that people love. And what our company does is we do event consulting, event planning, and event production. And event consulting we do to help people have more ideas. Event planning we do to help people have less stress. And event production we do with the goal in mind so that the team planning it and producing the event and the audience, they all have more fun. And these are some of the companies that we've done some work for. So in March, actually, you'll see the green one, Citizens Bank. In February, before the world shut down in March of 2020, I was in Boston as the MC for 500 professionals, mortgage professionals. And so we do a lot of different banquets. We do conferences. And pre-COVID, this is what would happen in our office. We had equipment that looked like this. And we would take this equipment and we would go to venues and we would set up on stages for the audience to show up in the room. And they would come and the goal in mind would be create an experience that they would remember. And we would always ask our clients, we would ask them these questions. When people are leaving your event, what do you want them to feel? And what do you want them to be thinking about? And then 2 weeks later, when they're talking about it, when they're sharing that story with a friend, what story do you want them to be telling? And then, of course, in March of 2020, the world shut down. And overnight, my boss, Billy, and I, it was March 11th, 2020. We were in New York meeting with the NFL, with Citizens Bank, and with Gary Vaynerchuk's company, if you know who that is, VaynerMedia. And we were flying up there, and we got three cancellations. And on the way back, the next 2 days after we flew back, we had over $1.8 million in business cancel. Our business canceled, right? And so as teachers, you know what this is like because school was basically canceled. We had to go from in-person to going online, and we were an in-person company. We would take our equipment like this and go in-person. Well, what we did is we cleared out the stage, or we cleared out our storage unit, and we created our own stage in our unit. This is kind of the in-between, and then for our first event, we created this studio, and we started to produce online events. And our very first in-person audience that we had was for this company. And in April of 2020, we had 250 people logged into an event, just like you guys right now, but imagine multiply by 250 people. And with 250 people watching, Billy and I, Michael, you can put me back on camera. Billy and I, we had this 2014 MacBook Pro. It was old. I needed to upgrade it, but I didn't have the time yet. And we had our very first paying client for an online event. And if you know MacBooks at all, you can use like, there's like hot swipe keys where you can do like four fingers and swipe one way and it does something, and two fingers and swipes one way. Well, we accidentally swiped the wrong direction and it went backwards in the web browser. And it locked us out of the event with 250 people for our first paying client for 5 minutes. I had to restart my computer and we had to go back in and hope and pray that it worked out. We eventually got back in, and here we are with our studio that I'm standing in right now. This is Billy, who's standing there, and we ended up getting more paying clients eventually after learning through mistakes. And so everything I'm going to share with you today comes from our own studio experiences, from our own in-person experiences, and from even renting online studios. Because here's the deal is that we don't know what is going to happen with the world, right? It's a little bit unpredictable. Maybe we have to do some online teaching. Maybe you have to do mostly in person and a little bit online. Maybe it's mostly online and a little bit in person. So I'm going to teach you how to do both. Okay, so everything I'm going to share with you guys for how to engage your audience is going to be through my experience with both in person and online. And now here's the thing, is that there's a simple math equation that I have for you. As an education major, I always lean towards math. I know a lot of you lean towards, am I a little bit out of focus? Am I a little bit blurry for you guys? Do I need to be in focus? A little bit? No? No, we're good? Okay, good. Just checking. It looks a little bit blurry on mine. I can see over here. I can see myself. So if we need to, Michael, we might be able to adjust the focus. But here's the math equation that I have for you guys for this. I lean towards math as a teacher. And so in order to have an engaged audience, you need to hold their attention and you need to interact with them and do it often. If you can do those two things throughout the entirety of your event, throughout the entirety of your class, you're going to have engaged students, okay? So attention, if you can hold their attention and interact with them often, you're going to have an engaged audience, an engaged classroom, an engaged set of parents. And so I've got three things. There's three things that you can do throughout your whole thing in order to hold their attention and in order to interact with them. Okay, you ready for these? They even rhyme so that you can remember them, all right? So here's the three. Number one is you can play a game. Number two is say their name. And number three is don't be lame, okay? So play a game, say their name, don't be lame. Because remember, the center of the bullseye for all three of these. I think I'm out of focus. It looks out of focus to me. It's going to drive me crazy. Y'all, this is real life, okay? We're in an event studio, and I'm even like walking forward to adjust it. I'm going to stand right here. All right, so there we go. That looks better. So play a game, say their name, don't be lame. And I'm going to read you in chat so I can see it. I see that you guys are talking to each other. Virtual is very convenient. Rachel says second that. Awesome. So no more chats have come in. All right. So play a game, say their name, don't be lame. And let's go deeper into the first one. But remember, the whole thing we're talking about is that people attend events, but they remember experiences. So your students, they are going to attend your class, but they are going to remember the times you're in class that you create an experience. Okay? All right. So play a game. What are some ways? And you might already be doing this, but here's a thing. If I go back to these three, you might already be doing all three of these. There's a quote, I can't remember who said it, but leaders don't need to be told as often as they need to be reminded. So maybe this is just a refresher for you guys, okay? And I can repeat that later if you need me to, but people don't need to be told as often they need to be reminded. All right, play a game. Now, if you remember back in the beginning, this is a brand new one. This is this or that in chat, okay? So this is a really simple way to interact with people online is by putting up an either or. You can do this in your classroom. You can call it something different, but putting, like if I were to put waffle fries or curly fries up on here, people get really passionate about these things. So in chat right now, I'd love for you to type in chat, are you a competitive person when you're playing games? Yes or not really? Yes, yes, for the most part, yes. Not really, says Wyatt. Yes, yes, yes. 1,000%. Thank you, Laura, for 1,000%. Samantha says, nope, very confidently. It's not even like the option's not really. She says, nope, not at all. I love it. Not really. Heidi, yes. And Taylor, not really. Usually from Cassidy. Thank you, guys. So here's the thing is that notice that it was kind of a split decision. When you play a game with your students, with your parents, there's some people are going to be competitive, and there's some people who are not going to be competitive. This is a non-competitive one. So we need to be mixing it up with our students and our parents. So do something. And again, a game, it doesn't have to be a full-on game where there's points and a winner. It can just be something really simple, okay? So number one is think about the competitive versus the non-competitive, and also think about the extroverts and the introverts, okay? Think about the extroverts and the introverts because what happened right here is on my screen, I can see your chat, but there's probably some people that are watching this that are not on video right now. But if I walk over here to my screen and I see you guys, sometimes if I ask for someone to unmute themselves and ask a question, the first people to do it are gonna be the extroverts. They're like, I need to talk to someone right now, right? Your students who are the first ones to raise their hand and in order to participate, they if you require them to get up in front of people, it's probably going to be the extroverts that do it first. But this or that in chat and a bunch of others that we have created in that we've created our company and that I'm sure you know about, these are ways that you can do it for the extroverts and the introverts. It could be to text in. It could be to type into chat. There's a bunch of different ways that you can do that, all right? Now, these are some statistics from this or that in chat to prove my point, all right? So with 182 people at an event, we did this or that in chat for 5 minutes, and we got 641 chat messages. So chat was just blowing up. And what's fun, you can see this. You can read each other's names. You can read their comments, and then I saw that you guys were replying to each other. Your students are going to do the same thing if you're online, and even in person, you can do this in small groups. Let's say you were to do this or that in the room, and you to break them up into small groups, and you just put up two options. Do you prefer conferences or competitions for FFA, right? We'd have a split decision there. And you can spark these conversations for your students or for your parents, and they're going to be engaged with each other. And they're going to be engaged with the content of what you're talking about. Because also notice what I did is at the beginning of this, even my talk, I did a couple of this or that in chats where it was coffee or tea, right? And then this last one I did, are you competitive or non-competitive, which relates to what we're talking about, which is play a game. Now, if you want some free ideas for you guys beyond what I'm going to share with you during this talk, Sarah gave me permission to give like a shameless plug. And so on our YouTube channel, which has almost 26,000 subscribers right now, I'm pretty proud about it. We're going to go full screen with this. You can scan this QR code with your phone if you want to, and it'll take you straight to our YouTube channel. And On our YouTube channel, we are uploading about 2 videos a week. One is going to be event tips and tricks, as well as icebreaker games. We've got an entire playlist of just icebreaker games. And this video with this thumbnail that you see right now, this video has almost 634,000 views as of this morning when I checked it, which is fun. So people kind of like it. And I'm pretty proud about it because I created that one, this one video that has that many views. So it's kind of a shameless plug. And it's kind of like, yeah, let me like dust my shoulders off because I had fun with that one. So not only that, if you are interested for your students, we do have a product. I'm offering a special discount for you guys as the Germinate All Access Pass guests. And so with the Elevate Game Library, it is 35 different videos, and we have this or that in chat. Like if you see a game where it has a keynote or a PowerPoint template, we've got it included in there. Because if you were to go to our YouTube channel or search online for games, this is the step that you'd have to take for doing it yourself. But with the game library, we've already built the games, built the slides, put it in there. So all you have to do is pick the game and play at your event. And again, there's over 35 different games. And that code, if you wanted to go there, is Germinate. We'll send you that link afterwards. I already sent it to Sarah, but the code is Germinate, and it gets you $20 off for your first year of access. And so it's only $97 for the year, so it'd be just $77 for you guys. Now, here's a statistic to back up why games are important for you, for your parents, for your teachers. According to Statista.com, in 2018, gamers accounted for 66% of the general U.S. population, which is up from 58% just 5 years earlier. Now, while gaming is classically seen as a hobby of the young and the male, data actually suggests that the love of gaming is shared by young and old alike. And I even saw some stats on their website that it's about 48% now female are gamers also. So that is actually goes to show you that it's not just like I like playing games with my friends. Your students are going to enjoy playing games with your friends, and so are the parents. The parents might be playing games online with their students as well. So doing something small is normal for our culture to play a game or do something fun and interactive, and it just breaks the ice and it lets everyone have a better time. So that is all about playing a game. Number two is say their name, all right? Here's what I want you to do. It's gonna be awkward, it's gonna be a little bit weird, but we're gonna do it anyway. I want everybody to unmute yourself, even if you're not on video, unmute yourself. And I want you to pick someone on screen, and I want you to say their name out loud, okay? On the count of three, everyone unmute yourself. So, yep, I see you guys. Unmute yourself. All right, we're all going to do it together. All right, pick someone. It's going to echo. It's going to be weird, but let's just do it anyway, okay? Pick someone's name and say it. 1, 2, 3, go. Caitlin Grantham. Okay, so say you can mute yourself now. But saying someone's name, the reason why I wanted to do that is to drive home this point. Even if you didn't hear that your own name, you said someone else's name, which means you're paying attention to one person in particular, right? And so saying a name is incredibly important. Dale Carnegie, he said this, "A person's name is to that person the sweetest, most important sound in any language." He wrote this in his book, How to Win Friends and Influence People. And so what's interesting is regardless of what language your students speak, if they speak English or Spanish, or if they speak TikTok, or if they speak some other language, if you say their name, like if I pick one of you out, I see Emily right there has an amazing headband on. I've got Katie Rittenhouse who has a great Carhartt hat on. I've got Wyatt who's my man holding it down in the education space. You're like my one other dude here on with us. I love it, Wyatt. Thank you for being here. So notice for those people, number one is their ears perked up and they're like, oh, he said my name and you started listening. And then number two is you might have been asking yourself, is he going to say my name next, right? And so your students and your parents are going to do that as well. Now, I'm going to play a quick game with you, and then I'm going to demonstrate why it's important to say their name as well and how you can do it, all right? So this is a fun game that we play called Emojiology, okay? So what you're going to do is I'm going to put on screen two different emojis, and you have to guess what word or phrase it's going to what word or phrase it spells out with emojis and type it in chat. Okay, here we go. Round number one. Round number one. What does this say in emojis? Yes, Elizabeth coming in strong with Cookie Monster. Correct, correct, correct. Okay, number two, round number two. What is this one? Yes. Oh, Michael, it's flying in here. Michael, who's the first person that said the correct answer? We got to scroll up. Julia, can you scroll up on here? We've got Jesselyn said it, definitely. Sarah, crushing it. Wait, no, was she? Yes, it was Sarah. Was it Sarah? No? Yeah, it was Sarah. It was Sarah. Bam. See, and look at that. I said her name, and Sarah threw her hands up in the air and celebrated, and now she's like, yes, that's me. Thank you. I'm Sarah. All right, Breadwinner is the next, is the round two, and I already gave you a sneak peek. What is this one? This one's going to make you think. Kind of thinking about it. Samantha's like, I'm not sure. What is that? Melissa's thinking hard. And ding, 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 Cassidy nailed it because that one is headphones. Headphones is that one. All right. So notice that one thing that I did is that when we played a game from this or that in chat, from way back at the beginning, one thing that I love about online events is I get to see people's names out here. And even if I'm mispronouncing your name, I'm still doing my best to say it. And so the first principle I have for you under say their name is that pronunciation matters, okay? Pronunciation matters. Why? Because go back to Dale Carnegie's quote, to that person, their name is the sweetest sound in any language, right? And so one thing that I did at the beginning, if you remember, when I couldn't pronounce someone's name, is I asked the question or I said, hey, will you please teach it to me? That's a really great way to get someone involved in your event. You're going to get them to interact and take action and be engaged with you. And then you don't have to worry about guessing. You can take a stab and say, hey, I'm going to do my best. Let me see if I can pronounce it correctly. And if I can't, then I would love for you to teach it to me. And that gives them it gives you the permission to try. It gives you the permission to also fail, right? Because notice, and I know what this is like, by the way. My last name is Specie. I have gotten Speckles, Spacey, Spicy, Species, literally every pronunciation on the planet. And even there was an announcer. His name was Sean, spelled the same way mine is, but he went by Scene, and he was living in Phoenix, Arizona, and he ruined it for me in the Valley, okay? So I know what it's like to have your name pronounced. And so pronunciation matters, though. So thank you for giving me the amen. I've had my last name spelled written mouse in the newspaper. Thank you, Katie, for dropping that in there. I love it. So the next one that I have for you is specifically for in-person events. You can adopt this for online events also, and I'll tell you how to in a minute. But these are for in-person classes or for sessions, and it's called the 25-foot rule. So the 25-foot rule is here on the screen. You can see that this is a gentleman standing on a stage, and he's got an audience around him. And so one thing that we teach our team at Elevate, one thing that we teach them is that whenever we are going to be on a stage, we go to everyone around within 25 feet, and we simply say hello. We spend probably the first 20, 30 minutes before the event starts doing this. We go around to everyone within 25 feet and we say hello. We try to get their name and get one small fact about them. Why would we do that? It's because then during the event, from the stage, we can use specific examples. Hey, I was talking to Katie about how she had her name mispronounced in the newspaper. Right? That is a very specific thing that you can do. And so at an online event, what it might look like is try to go live early. And for any of the early birds, you can just chat with them if you want to. You can open up the microphone. You can get with your students and ask them questions about their weekend, ask them questions about their coffee or tea preferences. It doesn't matter what you talk about, but the 25-foot rule, and then what you do with the 25-foot rule, what we like to do is we say, hey, I'm going to need your help. Because you're sitting right towards the front of the class, or because you're sitting right here in, I call it my fun zone, right near the stage, if I ask for you to give an applause for a person, like let's say, for example, you're doing an FFA and you have your students practicing their presentation for the competition coming up. You can ask the students that were there early that you got the chance to connect with. You can ask them for their help at participating better or more for your event and say, hey, I need your help. Will you be extra? Will you clap louder? Will you cheer louder? Will you have more fun? Because if you do, it's going to help everyone else have more fun. And so that's the 25-foot rule specifically for saying their name. All right. The last one, don't be lame. Do not be lame because you will lose them every single time. Okay. Don't be lame. Here's a couple of ways that you cannot be lame or that you can do to avoid being lame. All right. Number one is ask simple questions in order to get their involvement in, as well as just ask some fun ones. It doesn't all have to be related to the topic at hand. Share pictures. You can see that I showed you a picture of my family. I've shown you pictures of us on stages. Show videos, watch videos together, pull up a funny, ask the students, what is their favorite YouTube video that they've watched lately? The funniest one, right? You can interact with them through different ways. I'm going to teach you the six different ways that you can interact here in just a second. Break your class up, your event up into short segments. So if you have a 45-minute class, you can plan for it just as if it was a conference or a speaking engagement and say, hey, I'm going to spend 5 minutes doing this and then 10 minutes doing this and then another 5 minutes doing this. And I promise you it'll help people stay engaged because it feels like things are moving along. And then the last one is to change camera angles, specifically if you are at an event, an online event. And here's how you would do that if you didn't have, like, I've got camera one, I've got camera two, and I've got camera three over here, okay? So in our studio, we've got this. But what you can do if you're doing something online, like let's say, for example, you want to do a Zoom event for your FFA parents. You can give them a tour of your classroom by picking up your laptop or your phone and walking it around. I promise they will stay engaged with it. People love it. Now, in order to drive this home, this is a clip. I would love to know who has seen the movie Luca already on Disney Plus. Has anybody seen the movie yet? Raise your hands, raise your hand. Yes, I got a couple smiles. Who has not seen it? Has not seen it. You can shake your heads, type in no. I got all yes from Laura. Thank you. All right, so this is a trailer from the Disney's new, there's no spoilers, okay? I've only seen the first like 30 minutes or so. I haven't seen the whole thing, so don't spoil it for me either. But this is a trailer for the movie Luca, and here's what I want you to do. I want you to try to count how many times they change scenes and change camera angles in the 2 minute and 24 second that they have for a trailer. All right, here we go. Full screen, start counting. Quanta fretta, ma dove corri? Dove vai? Cacci ascolti per un momento, capirai. Lui è il gatto ed io la volpe. Stiamo in società. Wow, Luca, that was hard to watch.
You, coming?
We do not go anywhere near the surface. Got it?
Everything good is above the surface.
Walking.
Air!
The sky, clouds, the sun.
Whoa, don't look at it.
Just kidding. Definitely look at it.
Have you ever gone to the human town?
Yeah.
I'm kind of an expert.
Someone got lucky today,
Hey, leave them alone. Hop on.
Go start a club for losers.
My name is Giulia Marcovaldo. We underdogs have to look out for each other.
What's under the dogs?
This is my dad.
What do you think he kills with those?
Anything that swims.
Your life is so much cooler than mine.
There's a million things you think you can't do. All you need is a chance to try. Woo!
Something's fishy with you two.
This is too dangerous. Lucius!
I know your problem. You got a Bruno in your head.
A Bruno?
Say, Silencio Bruno.
Silencio Bruno.
Louder. Silencio Bruno.
Silencio Bruno.
Silencio Bruno.
Silencio Bruno.
Can you still hear him?
Nope, just you.
Good. Now hang on.
Silencio Bruno.
What's wrong with you, stupido?
You do it now. Just say the thing.
What's wrong with you, stupido?
Right, how did you do? Type in chat, how many scenes or camera angle changes did you count? Type it in chat, I want to see. Cassidy said 97, 101, 97, 79, 97, 87, at least one per second, Rachel, more than 100, Samantha, over 30, Anna, thank you, Anna. Shelby said 101, last count after 40, said Taylor. That took a lot of focus, yeah. I lost count. Yes, Sarah. I don't know if anybody else noticed it, but Sarah's, is that your daughter? Sarah came in. You're keeping a tally right there. Yes, Sarah. Thank you. 105. Okay. So I did my best to count too. I don't know the exact number, so I'm sorry for not knowing it. Maybe we can figure it all out together, but I counted 100 exactly. And that includes with the little Pixar jumping in with the Disney castle, because those count, right? Because they change something. And so notice how engaged were you trying to do something? I told you, I showed a video. I asked you to do something in the video. So not only that, were you engaged trying to figure it out, you were trying to solve a problem. So you were engaged that way, but also notice, pay attention to what our culture is doing, okay? Because Disney and the movies that we watch, we are used to being entertained by a screen. The screen in front of us, we watch Netflix on, we watch Disney Plus, we go to the TV and we're entertained that way, and they change camera angles for a reason. Disney and Pixar, they created that with 100 different camera angles and scene changes for a reason. It's to keep you engaged and to keep me engaged so that we keep watching until the end. So we see when it releases and who it was by, right? They want to keep us there the whole time. There's a statistic that if you don't capture someone's attention with a video within the first 6 seconds, then you're going to lose them, right? And it might even be shorter at right now. So if you can change your camera angle, even if it's just slightly adjusting, like let's say you're sitting at your desk and you just simply turn so that you've got a whiteboard next to you, and then you turn back so you've got a bulletin board. Even if it's just something slight, change it up, okay? This is a picture of behind the scenes with myself and a gentleman named Byron. We were doing an event for Harman Analytics, which is basically what they are is they're a Samsung company, and Harman is like the Harman headphones. And they had a 2-hour event live streamed to over 3,000 people. And we planned the event in 5, 10, and 15 minute segments. So 15 minutes for a panel and 5 minutes for Q&A, and then 15 minutes for a speaker, and then 10 minutes for this, and then 3 minutes for a video. And when we did this, we got this quote afterwards. Someone from the Harman company that was watching, they said, if you had asked me if I would have enjoyed a 2-hour event online, I would have said you were crazy. But for this event, time flew by and it was so engaging because we were doing exactly what I'm teaching you right now. So here is the principle that I have for you is change at least something at minimum every 15 minutes, okay? Change whether you can change the fact that you're going from pictures to videos. You can change the fact that you're going from question and answer time to let me present for 10 minutes, but change something every at least 15 minutes, okay? Now here, one of the other ways that we talked about for Don't Be Lame is to interact, all right? I've been doing this the whole time and I'm gonna do it with you again here in a minute, but one of the ways that we've been doing is interacting here on the screen. And so these are 6 different types of ways to interact that we can do at an in-person event and an online event. Number one is with your phone. Remember back when I showed you the YouTube, I said, hey, if you want to, you can scan this QR code. If you're online or you're in person with your parents, you can say, hey, you can go to this website and we can play a trivia game together. There's a bunch of free ones out there and paid ones, right? Number two is with polls. Here on Zoom, I don't have any prepared, but polls are a great way to do this, where you can do a simple survey with a poll where they're clicking a button, and then you can see statistics, and you can do that to gather data on your students and your parents as well. Number three is chat. We've been doing this a bunch. So we've still got all, I'm really excited to see at the end of this how many chat messages came in from the participants we had, right? I showed you the stat earlier of 185 people in 5 minutes with 684, right? Imagine if you had a stat like that from one of your classes to share with your principal from something that you did. How cool would that be? Or to share with your FFA leader in your county or in your state, all right? The next one is in the room. Now you can do this, like let's say for example, you're doing it online and you've got groups of students together. You can have them interact in a room that way. You can do breakout rooms on Zoom. You can do it in the room together where you can have people interact one-on-one if you have an in-person class. Or you can have them, again, break into small groups or do what we like to call an all skate. Y'all remember back in like skate, mine was skate station where we would go rollerblading and stuff, right? And all skate is where you get everybody together, okay? Then the fourth one is video. I know I'm aging myself. Thank you, Sarah, and you. Thank you for that. So video. You can do this on video as well. You can ask people to turn their video on or turn their video off. A couple of the games that we actually play requires people to have video on, and you can even preface them. If you really want people to have video on, you can say, hey, we're going to play a game that requires video to be on, and I'm going to give away a set of AirPods to the winner or something like that, right? Something incentivizing, or maybe I'm going to give away a free homework pass to the winner of this, something like that. And then the last one is, of course, audio. You can do a game, even if you don't have people with their video turned on, you can do it with the audio turned on, okay? You can do this with two people competing against each other while they have to buzz in with their voices or something along those lines, all right? So those are the six different ways. And here's the bottom line for interacting. I want you to remember this is to interact with your audience and do it often. Design your class, design your event with interaction in mind. Has anybody seen the movie Bohemian Rhapsody about the band Queen? Yes, I see a bunch of head nods. Awesome. So I'm going to show you a clip in case you haven't seen it. This is a clip about when it's not a documentary, but it's a great movie. And in this movie, it shows the behind the scenes of what it was like to when the band wrote the song We Will Rock You, right? The stomp, stomp, clap, stomp, stomp, clap, okay? So check this out and see what it's like for someone to design it with the audience interaction in mind. Here we go.
Stamp to this beat. Come on. Now, I want you to clap on the third beat.
What's going on?
You know if you're on time.
I want to give the audience a song that they can perform. So what can they do? Imagine thousands of people doing this in unison. Huh? Well,
what's the lyric?
So if you notice, they were telling the story about how, right before this clip, he was telling about how he wanted to design a song and write a song that allowed the audience to participate with them and to make music with them. So when you interact, design it in such a way so that your students and your parents can interact with you and give your audience something to do every 15 minutes. Notice I've been asking you to keep track of how many different things are in this one video, or type this in chat, or I've been asking you to raise your hand. I did it with a purpose to try to keep you guys engaged because I even have to do this as well, okay? All right, I've only got a couple more for you. I've already talked about how to change camera angles, and actually, when you do this, think about this. When you change camera angles, What if you were to do something specifically for your online event? I don't know if you guys still have to do them, but if you choose to, what if you were to have two different devices? Notice how I've even got, if you were to go to participants, if you want to on Zoom, you can click on participants and you can search for Elevate Tech. We've got two things that are logged in right now. The reason why I change camera angles right here to be able to show everyone on screen is so I can see you guys. Now, of course, I'm in a studio with lighting and microphone. It's a professional setting, but y'all can do this at home. You can do this if you have a second computer and a TV that's maybe like mounted on the wall above your fireplace. You can do your own Zoom wall like this by simply having a second device logged into your Zoom meeting, and then you can show people. So you can literally pick up, you can be normally sitting on your couch or at your desk, and then you can pick it up and you can show people's faces and you can show them. And this is designed so that we get more people with video on. And then the last one for you for changing camera angle is your second device could be a tablet or a phone logged in with you to help you change camera angles. You could have a second device, and there is a thing in Zoom specifically called spotlighting. So you would spotlight a device. That's, you literally just click on the person's, like if you scroll over someone else's name, if you're the host of the Zoom meeting, you can scroll over the name and there's three little dots that appear. You click those three dots and you can click spotlight, which what that means is it forces everyone to go into speaker view. Well, what if you had a phone that was logged in as a second device and you turn the you have the camera off most of the time, and then you say, hey, I want you guys to go on a little field trip with me. And you log in your phone, you spotlight it for everyone, and then you walk around outside and you leave your other computer where it is. So you can do this in some really simple ways. And so now what I want to do is I just want to quickly recap. These are all of them for you. These are the ways to interact in case you missed it earlier. You can ask questions. You can show pictures. You can watch videos. You can interact with them in different ways. You can plan short segments. And you can change camera angles. All right? So to wrap this up, make sure to remember to play a game, say their name, don't be lame. And if you remember back at the beginning, I told this story about this paying client. This paying client, we had 250 people. We were locked out for 5 minutes. I restarted my computer and we got back in. Well, what happened for the rest of the event is we did these things. We read on the computer the people's names. We picked up the computer and we changed camera angles because we didn't have multiple camera angles set up yet. We interact with them in chat by having them type something in. We had planned short segments. And so this one client, even though we locked our own selves out, we were the organizer, even though we locked ourselves out for 5 minutes with 250 people watching, they hired us for 9 more events that were just like this. They hired us for 2 more, and they added on us taking our equipment and going building a studio there, which was not cheap. We added nice backdrops to it. We added more people to it. And eventually we got to where we were even renting someone else's studio. And this is a video clip that I have muted for you, but this is an example for a big one. So this client ended up coming back to us 9 more times, which the reason why I'm sharing this with you is not to be braggadocious, but to tell you that it works regardless of your technology level. And you can start just like we did by making mistakes and by just testing things out. It can be a laptop, a 2014 MacBook Pro, and you can lock yourself out of your own event. But as long as you focus on getting better and actually making it engaging, your students are going to come back, your parents are going to come back, and you're going to be asked to do even more for the audience that you have. So my question for you is, what can engaging the audience do for you? What can engaging the audience do for you? What would it be like to have students that are engaged, to have parents that are engaged? And when your principal just happens to pop in to either your classroom in person or to your online class session, or they're watching the replay of it, what would having an engaged audience or statistics to share with them about these things, what would that do for you, for your career? What would that do for you for the impact that you want to have as an educator in order to help the students' lives be better, in order to help them have a better home life, a better future than maybe their parents had? So what can engaging the audience do for you?